This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a topic that I think you're really going to enjoy today, and not only enjoy, but be able to apply immediately in your practice. The title is Influence is Everything Today. Hey, before we get into that topic, two quick announcements. First of all, coming up on June 17th is our next masterclass. So that's coming up in a couple weeks from the time this episode will be published. The masterclasses are 3 hours long that allow us to do a deep dive into a very focused topic. And this particular masterclass is titled 6 Steps to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans. 6 Steps to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans. It's on June 17th, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. I want to invite you to come join us. Our masterclasses have historically sold out. We do limited attendance because we run them more like a workshop than a lecture. So if there's seats available, I'd like to invite you to come attend that masterclass. We'll put a link in the show notes at thrivingdentist.com/masterclass and invite you to come attend. 3 hours of CE, and some of the least expensive CE that you can acquire, and very practical information you can use in your practice. Hey, my next announcement has to do with this week's Thriving Dentist top clinical tip. He's a returning guest by popular demand, Dr. Chris Marchak. He's a prosthodontist, a practicing prosthodontist in Pasadena, California. And he is going to share some great tips with you about how to meet the expectations of your aesthetic patients. Powerful tips, because we know sometimes aesthetic patients can be demanding and we want to make sure that we're meeting their expectations. And he shares some wonderful tips gleaned from his years of experience where he always strives to meet his patients' expectations. At the very end of the clinical tip, Chris further shares a project that he's deeply involved in. It's called the I Love Dentistry Clinical Study Club, and there's a link to come join us in the I Love Dentistry Clinical Study Club. That segment, by the way, the top clinical tip, will immediately follow this introduction before we get into the coaching and action segment. So now, here's that top clinical tip from Dr. Chris Marchak.
Hi, Gary. This is Chris Marchak. I'm a prosthodontist in Pasadena, California, host of Clinical Chats, and the co-founder of the I Love Dentistry Study Club. It is a pleasure for me to share another clinical tip with all of your listeners. It makes me very happy that these clinical tips help your listeners around the world. I'd like to share a tip today about treating the aesthetic patient. You may have heard that aesthetics is the eye of the beholder, which is true, but is also trying to meet the expectations of the patient. Everyone is different. How can we read their minds? Expectations are truly unknown unless they are discussed and talked about. We also have to work with the ceramists or laboratory technicians and describe what the patients want or what we want to change to help our patients. We have the expectations or the translation of what the patient wants to us and then to the ceramists, and could be many disconnects. There are multiple expectations with the patient, the ceramist, and also you, the dentist. There are multiple computer programs also and apps out there to help minimize these expectations. But truly, you and the patient do not know how things will look until we see the restorations on the patient. And that patient looks in the mirror and says, "I love it," or, "I hate it." If we take a step back a moment, when I was in dental school, many of my instructors I had would evaluate my tooth preparations, and then they would say, go ahead and make a temporary. And they really didn't even look at the temporary. They said, just get it done. It doesn't need to look good or fit well because it's just a temporary. Well, today, I am not a believer of that. In fact, I try to make the best temporaries, what we call the provisional restoration, so I can discuss the aesthetics with the patient. I want these provisional restorations to minimize the expectations by creating the most detailed provisional restorations so I can discuss the aesthetics with the patient of what they like and what they want to change. These provisional restorations are the working model that I and the patient are able to modify, evaluate, and change. Once the provisional restorations are approved by the patient and meet your expectations, then we can make an impression or an intraoral scan of the provisional restorations, photograph, and evaluate color to give this information to the ceramist who's creating the restorations. Therefore, we are minimizing the expectations of the patient and the ceramist and yourself. This has made a huge difference in meeting patients' aesthetic desires and creating excellent results and having happy patients. Gary, I hope this helps your listeners as it has helped me in my practice. You know, also, Gary, want to share a special offer that is given to me to your listeners. If they want to join the ILD Study Club and participate in an incredible new way of learning through a virtual study club and have world-renowned clinical experts and have great discussions, they can join the ILD Study Club using my special code, and that is CMSC 2021, and they'll receive 50% off their yearly study club subscription. And it takes the dues from $199 a year down to $99 a year for life. They can follow the link to the ILDstudyclub.com to join. Gary, thank you so much for having me on the show again. I truly appreciate it. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another amazing episode of the Thriving Dentist Podcast. In today's Coaching and Action segment, we are going to be talking about influence is everything today. This is Naren, your co-host. As many of you know, I come from a marketing background, and influence is something that I'm very, very interested in and passionate about. So I'm really excited about this Coaching and Action segment, Gary.
Naren, I am as well. And we're going to talk about really the world recognized leader in the science of influence, and that's Dr. Robert Cialdini. We're going to talk about him and talk about the six fundamental principles of influence. But before we do that, I have a couple of ways to kind of get into this topic for our listeners. And the first one goes back to the early 2000s. I want to kind of demonstrate why influence is so important. So the early 2000s, I think it was 2001, 2002. So we're talking about almost 20 years ago now. There was a very popular TV show that was called Extreme Makeover. Extreme Makeover.
I remember that.
Yeah. And it was an interesting concept. They would have patients on the show. It was an ABC show. They would have patients on the show where their panel of experts would provide an extreme makeover regarding their specialty services. So there were plastic surgeons that were on the panel. Dr. Bill Dorfman was the dentist. And so he would provide dental services. There were hair and makeup experts. There were fitness experts that could work on, you know, changing physique. And they would literally do these procedures over a period of time. And then edit those to make a show. And at the very end of the show, they would show the reveal. In other words, they'd show the before photos and then show the patient would come out onto the, you know, onto the screen, you know, bursting through a big banner, showing the after version. And Naren, if you remember that show, the after versions were so profound that you couldn't help but watch the show and say, wow, that's amazing. The way that individuals were transformed with, you know, healthcare services. A little backstory on this that nobody knows about. But Dr. Dorfman, Bill Dorfman, being the dentist on the show, he was part of the advisory committee that would choose the patients to go through the extreme makeover. And Naren, the importance of that is that he always picked people that had serious dental issues so that the dentistry would really show up large in the after photo, because they were literally transformational cases. These weren't minor dental cases. They were radical dental cases. So he chose, as part of the advisory committee, he chose patients that had serious needs dentally so that dentistry would be highlighted. And very often at the end, you know, where the patient might have multiple procedures, it was often the dentistry that made the biggest deal. And what that did, and this is how it ties to influence, is that that show was really largely responsible for creating the extreme interest in cosmetic dentistry in the early 2000s. Kind of the what's considered to be the golden age of cosmetic dentistry, the early 2000s. You know, 15 million people a week saw that show.
Mm.
All about influence. It was all about Dr. Dorfman, the patient, and the way dentistry took a front seat into transforming these people. I can hardly think of a better example of influence. Would you agree?
Agreed. The other thing that comes to mind is, have you seen the movie Meet the Fokker?
Yeah, of course.
And one of the movies, I don't know which one, but there's sign language. And I think he's signing with the little baby, and sign language took off because, you know, because everybody like saw the movie and they're like, oh, wow, it's a new trend.
Well, and another kind of popular, this is very timely. This is happening right now as we're recording this. Of course, we're all familiar with the TV show Saturday Night Live.
Yes.
Well, this coming Saturday, as we're recording this, by the time this airs, this will have already happened. But the guest host on the Thriving Dentist Show is none other than Elon Musk.
Yes.
Musk. Now, let's think about that for a minute. And, you know, why would, you know, the show choose to have, you know, Elon Musk as a guest host? They normally have celebrities, sometimes athletes, but it's normally someone that has a very high profile in the entertainment world, you know, as a celebrity or as an athlete. And Elon
Musk, who can act, right? Who can act or do a comedy skit, like who's funny and stuff like that. Yeah.
As a personality.
Yeah.
And so obviously they've chosen Elon Musk because so many people will be interested in watching it just to see how he does, you know, as a guest host. And it's influence. It's influence again. You know, they wouldn't pick someone to host the show that didn't have influence, because obviously Saturday Night Live is interested in increasing their viewership. And so it's all about influence, you know, and we titled this particular episode, you know, that it's influence is everything today, and it is in dentistry. And this is a topic that our listeners need to really get their arms around. And we're going to get into kind of a deep dive into this coaching and action segment, and also in the Q&A segment about how our listeners can adopt influence principles successfully in their practice, subtly and successfully. Naren, would you start with talking about the six fundamental principles of influence as defined by Robert Cialdini? And perhaps for any of our listeners that are new to that name, maybe give a short summary of who Robert Cialdini is and why this is important.
Absolutely, Gary. I'm a big fan of Dr. Robert Cialdini. And just to give you some backstory, Dr. Robert Cialdini is a professor emeritus at the University of Arizona.
You got to get that right. They're at Arizona State University.
Oh, Arizona State University.
That's very different than the University of Arizona. And believe me, I live in Scottsdale, and he's Arizona State, which I'm sitting about 20 minutes away from as we're recording this.
Absolutely. And he's a professor there, and he's a professor of psychology. And he wrote a book in the 80s called Influence. And it's a simple book. And he didn't really write it for marketing people or people who wanted to influence. He wrote it for the average person trying to explain to us how we decide, how we say yes to things and how we say no to things. And he tried to understand what are the six principles that when applied or when present make us say yes more often than not. Of course, he was looking at it from how can other people do this to us so we are more aware of it. And he studied, he did a lot of research. He studied tens of thousands of people in all you know, different countries, different environments and so forth. And he distilled it down to six principles. And what he found out is those six principles, when applied, creates a moment. In that moment, people are three times more likely to say yes. So the secret is, okay, how do I apply the principle, you know, and then how do I leverage the moment? So moment, the principles create the moment, and then you have to tap into it. In other words, if you don't tap into it and you try to tap into it 10 minutes later, it's not going to work. You have to tap into it right then and there. So that's the essence of what he did. And he wrote a new book called Persuasion. So the idea here is so in other words, you preemptively persuade somebody. So how do you kind of persuade somebody by leveraging these six principles? So the second book, which came out recently, both of them are New York Times bestsellers, is all about, that's written more for marketing people and more for people who want to learn about influence. So that's all about how do you now apply these six principles? He gives hundreds of examples in all kinds of situations. Amazing books.
And in the process of his academic work, his colleagues came to recognize him as being the world's foremost expert on the psychology of persuasion and the psychology of influence. Let me name those six, the six fundamental principles, and then we're going to talk about two of those in a kind of a deeper dive into two of the six principles. But Naren, I want to give you credit. Because at your digital marketing firm, Equa, you've taken these six principles and you've completely adapted them to dentistry. And, you know, we get to experience those in my practice as a client of Equa. We get to experience those principles at work in my practice. And the coolest thing about these principles is they all happen on a subtle basis. It's not like a sledgehammer to the head, but in fact, it's happening in a very subtle way to influence your patients to, for example, choose you as a dentist. And then further, to influence your patients to make dentistry a higher priority, and further, to influence your patients to desire to have the best possible oral health. It's all those things at play. Well, here's those six principles. This is according to Dr. Robert Cialdini. I'll number them 1 through 6. They're not numbered in importance. They're numbered so I can remember to cover all of them. First principle is reciprocity. The second A principle is commitment or consistency. Commitment, consistency. Those are kind of combined into the second principle. The third one is social proof. I'm going to let you go back and kind of give a little thumbnail descriptor for each one, Naren. Is that okay?
Absolutely, Gary. Yes.
The third one is social proof. Well, we all know what social proof is that way, but Naren will give you his spin on that. The fourth one is authority. The fifth one is liking, and the sixth one is scarcity. Let me name them again, Naren, and then you give a short descriptor for each one. Number one, reciprocity. Number two, commitment, consistency. Number three is social proof. Number four is authority. Number five is liking. Number six is scarcity.
Thank you, Gary. Appreciate it. Let me define each principle. Reciprocity. The idea simply is returning a favor. You know, it comes back. All of these principles are based on human conditioning. In other words, things that have been ingrained in us, sometimes in our lifetime and sometimes in multiple lifetimes. Throughout history, we have been taught, you know, it doesn't matter what country you come from, what ethnic background you're from, that if someone is kind to you, if someone does something for you, you need to pay it back. So that's the idea of reciprocity. So the principle here is if you give something to someone and they are feeling grateful, that's the best time to ask for something if you want to ask them for something, that very moment. The next principle is commitment and consistency. This is the most powerful of all principles. We as humans are consistent and committed to what we do. So let me explain. There are two parts, but they're kind of interconnected. Commitment meaning I make a promise to Gary. Hey, Gary, I'll talk to you at this time to do the podcast recording. So now I keep that promise. He keeps that promise. Why? Because we made a commitment to each other. Consistency is same thing, but it's kind of like mindset. So you believe certain things. Let's say you come from a family where going to church is really important, and you were going to church when you're growing up, and that's something that kind of is ingrained in you. So you will continue that tradition, or getting married, or staying married, or believing a certain belief system. So maybe you are somebody who's kind of a little bit on the left versus on the right, or vice versa, and then you kind of stay consistent with that. So commitment and consistency is the idea that you're going to stay committed to your the commitments you verbally make or make in other ways, plus you're going to stay committed to those mindsets, those belief systems you believe in. In other words, your actions are going to be kind of a reflection of those belief systems. The next one is social proof. This has become more powerful in 2020 because it's more easily available. Think of Google reviews. If you want to grow your business, one of the best ways to do that today is to get more Google reviews every single day, every single week. Why? Because 95% of the people today rely on it when they decide which dentist to go to. So social proof, very powerful in 2020, and it's getting even more powerful because, there's so much information available to us. The fourth one is authority. Authority simply says that we tend to listen to authority figures and take their advice. Simple example, Oprah Winfrey. She has sold more than 55 million books. Why? Because we, or a lot of people, think Oprah is an expert. So when she recommends a fiction or when she recommends a cookbook, doesn't matter what book she recommends, people tend to buy it. So authority is a very powerful principle. So the question there is, how can you as a dentist be seen as an authority, seen as an expert? The fifth one is liking. Liking is all about we tend to do business with people we like. We like people for two reasons. One, we like them because the person cares about us, is interested in us. Or we like them because we have something in common. I am a parent, you are a parent. So we have something in common. So liking is another very powerful principle that can apply in many different ways in dentistry. Last one is scarcity. Scarcity is the principle that kind of says we want things we can't have. Two examples, if you are the captain of the football team, or you are the leader of the cheerleading squad, there's only one of you, so everybody wants to go out with you and so forth. I'm just using a high school example. Or in a more relevant example could be Apple. When every time Apple comes out with a new phone, they're always sold out. The fact that we can't have it right away makes us want it even more. So Apple does a masterful job in orchestrating on, with their media partners, how everyone is standing in line trying to get an Apple product. Scarcity is something that's the last principle. So those are the six principles, Gary.
Hey, thank you, Naren. I want to pick two of them and really apply these to dentistry. I'm going to start with authority. Now, doctors, I want you to think about this for me for just a minute. I think it's a fairly good bet that you have many physicians as patients in your practice, or at least some physicians as patients in your practice. And so one of the things you could do is you could go to those physician patients and ask them to write a testimonial for you. Obviously you're going to ask their permission and make sure it's okay if you put that on your website, make sure if you use it for marketing purposes. And in most cases, the physician will be happy to oblige. And they write this wonderful testimonial, and the testimonial will have their credentials, MD, after their name, or it might say Dr. So-and-so if they'd prefer to have before their name. And now imagine that being placed strategically on your website, not only on, the testimonial page or the, here's what our patients have to say, but imagine it as a banner coming across the top of your website pages, where maybe every third name or every fourth name is a physician. And imagine how mom's going to feel as she sees that banner come across. She may not know the physician, likely she doesn't, but she sees the MD after his or her name. And she says, wow, if physicians who clearly know about healthcare have chosen this office for their dental care, that must be the right one for me. I need to go here too. So there's a simple example of the concept of authority at work in your practice and how that can be adapted to your practice. The second one I want to kind of highlight is the concept of social proof. And I'm going to get really narrow with this one because social proof can apply in many ways in your practice, but I want to get narrow on this one. And I want you to really knock it out of the park. So I'm going to talk about Google reviews. I want you to embrace a goal. And maybe this is one of those BHAGs. Remember the acronym BHAG, Naren?
Big, Hairy, Audacious Goal, from Jim Collins.
Yeah, Jim Collins, the author, created that acronym, BHAG, pronounced BHAG, Big, Hairy, Audacious Goal. Here's a big, hairy, audacious goal. To become the dental office with the most Google reviews in your community. The most Google reviews. Now, that may not be easy because there may be others that have a little bit of a head start on you, but any one of you can get there and do this. So I want you to become the office that has the most Google reviews, because by doing so, you will be creating a grand slam around the concept of social proof. Now, imagine if mom's looking for a dentist, she's searching Google to find a dentist near her, and Google won't tell us what their ranking algorithm is. Of course, that's their secret sauce. They won't tell us that. But they do tell us that the process of reviews is heavily weighted, and it's one of the factors that's weighted for them to determine their ranking algorithm. And as a result of having the most Google reviews, you are likely to show up in the Google Maps section. Likely to show up if you have the most Google reviews. Now, imagine if mom's looking for a dentist in her area, and she sees that this office has, 412 Google reviews, and the other two offices in the maps have less than 100. At a subconscious level, she's going to think you're better than them. So you're going to be influencing her. Actually, Google reviews is going to be influencing her to say, this is the office I need to check out. Now she's not going to read 412 reviews, but she may click on some and read them. And now you've got the power of the voice of the patient providing social proof that your practice is the right one to go to. Well, there's two adaptations of those six concepts. And I think both of those, hopefully we've given you some actionable things you can apply in your practice and apply in your marketing to really put your arms around the concept of influence. And Naren, what I've learned in my own practice, remember his second book was titled Persuasion. By the way, that's not a mispronunciation. the actual word is persuasion. But he kind of coined his own term, PRE-suasion. And if you incorporate this material onto your website and potential patients spend some time going through this at a very subtle level, they're not only being influenced to choose your practice, but they're being influenced to make dentistry a higher priority in their lives. And they're really sort of, you're doing some very important work to help the patient take a higher priority of their oral health. And that can be done through these subtle persuasion concepts on your website. And we have Dr. Robert Cialdini to thank for kind of pioneering these concepts. Let me also tell you a little behind the scenes information. Dr. Cialdini is writing he's in the process of writing his third book. And that one's going to be published shortly. And that third book, I can guarantee you, is going to be another New York Times bestseller. But one thing you could do for some homework is read the first two. Read Influence, which is the first one. Read the second one, which is Persuasion. Both of those, by the way, are available on Audible. So if you're more of a listener, you can listen to those. And that will prepare you to understand more about these concepts and make the third book that's coming out soon be something that you can just jump on and apply in your practice as well. Well, Naren, thank you for your contribution to this Coaching in Action segment. Fun topic to share with our listeners. And I took a sneak peek ahead of time. We have some great questions in the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment that kind of will allow us to amplify some of these concepts even further.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. Today's topic is influences everything today. I have some amazing questions for you, Gary. But before I get to the question, I have a quick announcement, which is we are going to be creating a cheat sheet, influence cheat sheet, that's going to be added as a resource. You know, anybody who's interested, go to the website, you know, follow the podcast page, and you can download this resource. It's a Thriving Dentist Influence Cheat Sheet. You're going to get some value from it. Now, Gary, let me jump into the questions. The very first question. I like your challenge, Gary, of becoming the dental office with the most Google reviews in my community. We seem to go through cycles where we get a lot of reviews and other times we are not getting any. Can you suggest a good way to ask patients for reviews?
Wow, I love the transparency and the candor of that question. And doctor, if you're experiencing that in your practice, you've got a lot of company. It seems like, you get reviews and you're on a run and then all of a sudden you get a dry spell and you're not getting any reviews. So, you know, how can you overcome that? Great question. So remember, Naren, in the beginning when you were talking about Dr. Robert Cialdini, you said that it's all about understanding these principles, but it's about leveraging the moment as well. Now, here's how I want to answer that question, doctor. I want you to think of this as a team sport. Reviews are a team sport. It's not just up to you, or it's not just up to your office manager, or it's not just up to your hygienist. It needs to be a team sport. Now, the truth is, certain personality types are way more comfortable to ask for reviews than others. Now, Naren, we've done a discussion in past episodes about the DISC personality styles, the DISC personality styles. Naren, I'm going to put you on the spot. If you don't get it right, we'll edit it out, but I think you're going to get it right. What personality style do you think is the most likely team member to be comfortable asking for reviews?
I think it's going to be I number one and D number two.
Yeah, it's going to be by far and away I. Right. All the other three are distant in the background. The I person, the social, outgoing, gregarious, that everybody's their new best friend, they are the one. And the truth is, some dental offices don't have a single I personality on the team. But here's all you need to do. Doctors, think about your role is helping your team members put their antenna out. Put their antenna out and listen for natural ways to make a request for a review. Natural ways. For example, this will happen every week in your practice, doctor. I guarantee that, because I know our listeners, this is going to happen in your practice. A patient is going to turn to you and say something like, "Doc, I can't believe you even gave me a shot today. I didn't feel a thing." Okay? I'm hopeful that that happens every week in your practice. By the way, if that isn't happening, go take a course on how to give painless injections and make that start happening, because that's a practice builder. Now, your assistant, who most likely is an S personality type, she's not the I, she's an S. That's why she's an assistant. Okay? It fits that personality type. She heard what the patient said and she can say, "George, thank you for telling us that. You know, that absolutely makes our day. We want to make every visit comfortable for our patients. Thanks for letting us know that." You know, George, there's a lot of people that don't go to the dentist because they're afraid of the shot. Hey, would you do me a favor when you get a chance to write us a Google review and maybe say what you told us? That might help more people find, you know, more people have the courage to go to the dentist. Thanks in advance. So see what I did there, Naren?
Yes.
So it's having the antenna out and looking for the, you know, the opportunity. That was Robert Cialdini's point, is leverage the moment. And so we just have to have our team members tuned in for those opportunities. You know, when someone says to a dental assistant or a hygienist, "I'm so happy I had this done," you know, there's the leverage, there's the opportunity. And so just spend a little time in a team meeting talking about having our antenna out and listening for those opportunities. Now, Naren, another thought comes to mind because it's one of the ways we have, in my own office, in my Life Smiles Dental Practice, have been successful at receiving reviews. I'm going to put you on the spot for just a minute. Tell me how many reviews I have as of this very moment, as of the moment that we're publishing this.
I think it's around 725, Gary. That's kind of 24 hours old, but hopefully okay. That's accurate enough.
725. Well, one of the ways...
I'll do something extra. If you want to figure out what Gary has when the podcast comes out, just go and Google Life Smiles Dental Care Phoenix, and you will realize that Gary gets a ton of reviews every day.
Yeah, we do get a lot of reviews. And we also have you to thank for that, Equa. And we use some of your tools that you provide, you know, as our marketing service. You provide some tools that make collecting reviews very easy. You guys can do the same things that we've done and use those tools with success in terms of building reviews. Naren, it might be useful to put a link to the marketing strategy meeting in the show notes, so that any of our listeners could schedule a meeting with Lila Stone and learn more about how Equa can help them master the world of marketing today.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's a meeting where Lila would prepare for 6 hours and then figure out how are you doing today on Google, as well as, you know, what you're doing right, what you are not doing as well. And then help you develop a 1 year plan that focuses on both sides of marketing, helping people find you. And then of course, influencing them, which is where Cialdini comes in so that the phone rings. So it's both parts. And she'll go through and help you develop that 12-month plan. It's complimentary. We'll put a link.
Awesome.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the second question. I may be unusual in this regard. I actually don't have many physicians in my practice. Can you suggest other ways to apply this authority principle?
Great question. And you know, I think we always see things through our own lens. And in my own practice, we do have a lot of physicians in our practice, but that may not be true for everyone. So that's a really great question. And yes, there are other ways to do this. Doctors, think about your classmates at dental school. Ask your classmates to write a testimonial for your practice. Think about the doctors that the dentists that you go to your CE courses with. Maybe you have a group of dentists that you tend to get together in CE courses with. Another great group of people to ask. So imagine how that review would sound there and how the testimonial, would sound. And it could be something like this. I'm obviously, they'll make up their own testimonial, but I can imagine one saying something like this. I went to dental school with Dr. So-and-so, and I have to tell you, he is not only an amazing dentist, but he cares very deeply for his patients. If you're looking for a dentist, you couldn't make a better choice than Dr. So-and-so. And it's signed, you know, DDS. So another dentist that is singing your praises, and that likely is a dentist in another city, you know, from somewhere else. It doesn't matter because it's the concept of authority. Just like you said, Naren, in Oprah's book club, it doesn't matter who the author is. It doesn't matter what the title of the book is. It doesn't matter what the topic could be, fiction, could be nonfiction, could be poetry. It doesn't matter. If Oprah recommends the book, they fly off the shelf. Same way that if an MD writes a testimony, if a DDS, DMD writes a testimonial, it adds instant credibility.
Absolutely. And we do have tools to support you with this. So, of course, one of the things we do is help you implement all these tools. I'm talking about Equa. So anyways, there are tools out there and you can, you know, do this. Let me get to the third question. For many years, I had a before and after photo book printed in my office. Not sure what happened, but we don't have that anymore. Is it a good idea to be using before and after photos?
Absolutely, but it's time to convert that to digital, not analog. You know, who knows what happened to that book? Maybe it got worn and the janitorial service threw it away. You know, who knows? But it's time to replace the book from a physical book to a digital book. And one of the things that you can do is you could create a digital photo album on an iPad, on a tablet, and you can organize those by category. So, Naren, I'm going to put you on the spot again here, and I want you to tell me what principle is at work here. So, imagine that you've got your different before and after photos arranged by category. Maybe it's cosmetic dentistry as a category. Maybe it's replacing old amalgam fillings as another category. Maybe it's adult orthodontics as another category. In fact, let's go to cosmetics as my example. And imagine that we're talking to a patient, female patient, in her 30s, about a smile design. And imagine that you could pull up your iPad and you're going to pick examples of patients who are women in their 30s that you've helped have the smile of their dreams. And even though these are just close-ups, you know, middle of nose, middle of chin, middle of cheeks, you can still tell they're women, usually by the fact that they might have lipstick on or the shape of their lips or so on. So imagine that here's a patient in your 30s and we're showing her four or five examples of patients you've helped have the smile of their dreams. And those happen to be women also in their 30s. What influence principle is at play here?
Yeah, this is called similar others, which is an advanced form of social proof. So what fundamentally it means is we think we are unique. So when we see someone else like us who is successful, who has the outcome that we are looking for, we believe that we will get the same outcome because you have helped someone like us get the same outcome. So reviews are like, you know, it could be a 90-year-old person and a 16-year-old person, right? It's very broad. This is very targeted because you are looking at a picture that's very much like you. So it's under the social proof category, Gary. Now we,
it's the way under we, liking, I would say that there's actually two principles at play. One would be liking. We like, you know, other people that are like, and they're seeing people that are like them.
Right.
But it's also under social proof because if you've shown them four or five cases, one of the things subconsciously the patient's thinking, well, this isn't your first rodeo. You've done this before.
Right. Right.
So very much social proof is at play in that. But doctor, get to work on putting befores and afters in that. And I do it in a tablet. And I would kind of encourage you to invest in the iPad Pro, you know, that big 12.9-inch diagonal tablet, and organize them by categories and keep updating those. And really, this is kind of another way to make sure that taking before and after photos in your practice is a regular protocol, and you don't slip and get out of practice with that as well. But nothing like seeing other cases that you've helped have the smile of their dreams create interest in the patient moving forward with treatment recommendations.
I have an awesome question to end this off, Gary. That's the fourth question. Seems to me that influence can absolutely apply to our team as well. I have a relatively new team where some team members did not come back after COVID-19. How can I influence my team to truly embrace my vision?
Wow, that's a really insightful question because for the most part, we've been using the concept of influence in terms of how we influence our patients. However, the concept of influence is much broader than that. Doctor, how are you influencing your team members? And that's a great question, very insightful question. Well, how can you influence your team to truly embrace your vision? You know, it's a challenge right now, Naren. Many offices are extremely busy right now, you know, as more and more people have gotten the COVID vaccine and states are relaxing their restrictions. There's a surge in demand right now. And sometimes we are so busy working in our practice that we don't have any time to work on our practice. By the way, our listeners will know that Stephen Covey, you know, is a mentor of mine in his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. Habit number seven, he called sharpen the saw. And what he meant by sharpen the saw is you have to spend time working on your business and not always working in it. So sometimes when we get into a surge where we're super busy right now, team meetings can drop off the schedule. Oh, you know, even suggested good-heartedly by your team. You know, your office manager can say, doctor, I'm having trouble finding appointment time. You know, we have a team meeting scheduled next week. Can we just cancel that team meeting and do appointments? And that's kind of an easy thing to fall into the trap of doing, isn't it, Naren?
Yes, yes. Absolutely.
However, I might suggest if you've got a newer team, as I heard in the question, never better than investing in getting your team on board with your vision. And I want to share a very tactical thing. You know, we talk about vision. It sounds kind of big and fluffy. And I think for some people, the concept of vision goes in one ear and out the other. Is that a fair statement, Darren?
Absolutely, yes.
Vision smision. Let's get to work. You know, so here's something very practical that you could do that will influence your team members. Well, you guys know that I am a massive fan of a relationship-driven practice, That's where we know our patients' names, their spouses' names, their kids' names, their dogs' names, their hobbies, their interests, where they went to college, what important dates are in their life, what's going on in their life. Darren, stop me if you've heard this before. You have heard this, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, massive fan of a relationship-driven practice. And when you ask most dentists, is yours? Yeah, mine's relationship-driven. But really, is it? And here's a quick way you can test that. There needs to be a place in your computer, electronically, where we keep personal notes about patients. And it does not belong in your chart notes because it will get buried and lost and you'll never see it. It belongs in a special place that we can pull up during the morning huddle and quickly look at that and do a quick study and be prepared for the patients we're seeing today. And here's the task I want you to give to your team members. So oftentimes I see the only person that enters notes in that notes section is the doctor. It really needs to be a team sport. So invite your team members to enter information because they'll pick up more information than you will from your patients. And the act of doing that will reinforce to your team members how important the relationship aspect of your practice is, that it's relationship driven. Now, if it's sometimes what happens, and I know we've all seen this, we talk about something once and then check it off our list and move on to the next thing. Naren, if a dentist brings this up once, checks it off of his or her list, and goes on to the next project, what do you think the success of that'll be?
Very, very little. Because, you know, one of the principles is commitment, right? If you're not committed and you don't stick with it, it doesn't stick with the team either.
Right. So simple exercise. It doesn't have to be heavy. It doesn't have to be hard. But introduce this. Explain, you know, let everyone know where it is and encourage them. After the patient, jump in there and write a quick note. It could be just the dog's name. It could be something that's going on in their life. And if that isn't happening, bring it up in the morning huddle. Hey, guys, now this is the doctor's voice. Hey, guys, you know, last week we talked about that, about adding notes. And I noticed we've all been busy. We've been distracted. And I haven't seen you adding notes. Let's go back and read. This is important to me. Let's go back and get this right. And furthermore, the next day, you could go back and review this and compliment one of your team members for doing that.
Yes.
And say, Linda, look at this. Here it is, guys. Look what Linda put in there. That information is golden to me. Thank you. Thank you. Now, doctor, I want you to do one more thing. I want you to use this information. And here's how I want you to do that. By the way, I'm not going to win any popularity contests in what I'm about to share. And I realize that, but I'm going to share it anyway. Doctor, I want you to come in 15 minutes before the start of your morning huddle. In my office, that's 6:30 a.m. The morning huddle is 6:45. So you'd be in there at 6:30 on this recommendation. I know I just lost some of you on this one, but stick with me. And I want you to pull up the notes on every patient you're seeing today, whether it be restorative side or hygiene side, and do your homework. And let your team members know how valuable that is to you by having these notes. And that's how I think, doctor, a few steps that you can begin to influence your team to truly embrace your vision. And by the way, again, that's not going to be one and done. That's not going to be, okay, we talk about it once, check it off our list, and we move on. That's going to be something that you want to continually work on. Well, Naren, we've had some great questions. This has been a fun topic. If Robert Cialdini is new to any of you, I'm excited that, Naren, that you and I had a chance to influence our listeners by someone that is a mentor to both of ours. If he's old hat for you, it's a good exercise to review what we've learned from Dr. Robert Cialdini because it truly is game-changing. On that note, I want to take a minute and say thank you. Naren, thank you for all the support in doing this podcast. Thank you for you and your 174 team members at Equa for helping me, my practice, master the world of digital marketing. And what that means specifically is we get the number of new patients we need every month, and we also receive the quality of new patients that we need every month. And I have you and your 174 team members to thank for that. So thank you. Also want to take a minute and thank all of our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you here on the Thriving Dentist Show. Three things you can do to support our work. Number one, tell a colleague about the Thriving Dentist Show. Number two, if you haven't done it already, jump on iTunes and write us a review. It helps more dentists find us. That's social proof for us. And number three, hit the subscribe button. If you hit subscribe, it means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me say thank you for the privilege of your time today and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.